And to help us make sense of today's market movements, we're now joined by Kerwin Chan of COL Financial. Good afternoon, Kerwin. Welcome to Market Edge.
Good afternoon, Sunny. Good to be back.
Good to have you here again. What a day. We were doing so well early on in trading, even reaching 7,100 at some point during the day, only to recede back to 7,041, 0.4% lower. Volumes also so-so at more or less 5 billion. What other highlights have you seen in today's market activity?
So yes, like just what you mentioned, the index did reach an intraday high of 7,137. But then unfortunately, we saw some profit taking later in the market, which forced us to close a bit lower. On a positive note, we're still above our 7K psychological support. So we think that this was driven by the improved investor sentiment in the local market because of the less hawkish nature of both the Fed and the BSP. So I think another catalyst for the strong rally these past few days in the equity market is because of the retreating 10-year bond rates, which we see is already now at 6.16% from its recent highs of around 7%. I think one of the major movers today was MPI, which was the TOPS index gainer.
Right. I'd like to talk about that, though. MPI shares have traded very actively and, of course, also appreciating, even reaching 7% intraday. We've been seeing a similar price appreciation last month for MPI. I mean, is this still a continuation of the uptrend for the Pangilinan unit? And what else, perhaps, is fueling the buying spree, particularly for MPIC?
Yeah, so actually recently there have been rumors floating around about a potential deal wherein a Japanese company is interested in acquiring a substantial stake in the conglomerate. And based on MPI's performance today, it looks like that deal might, you know, happen in the short term. So we saw a while ago, investors started sizing up their positions in the stock. Unfortunately, there's still no news yet, but share price action could remain strong in the short term as the privatization story starts to unfold. This may be the catalyst that MPI needs to finally reverse the sluggish share price performance that we've seen over the past few months. Nonetheless, we like MPI because of it remains undervalued. At its current price, it's still trading at a 50%+ discount to its net asset value.
Okay, now speaking of sluggish price movements, of course, a lot of that sometimes would depend on whether a stock is a heavyweight or not. And we're talking about a change or some changes in the index that might affect sluggishness in prices. Of course, bets are up for Union Bank and DMC to join the 30-company index. How is price action for these shares today and for those up for removal, if you will?
Yes, so just like what you said, Stanley, we think that DMC and UBP are top candidates for inclusion in the next PSEI rebalancing for Feb. It seems like they met the numerous criteria needed to be included in the index. Based on their performance today, DMC ended flat while UBP ended up 1%, sustaining their upward momentum, which we've seen over the past couple of trading days. But of course, since these will be added, there will also be deletions, which we think will be MegaWorld and RLC, who failed to meet the requirements to stay inside the 30 stock index. So a while ago, we saw both MegaWorld and RLC jumping over 5%, as we think that this is likely priced in already. We saw over the past few months that MegaWorld and RLC share price has been underperforming as investors were already anticipating the removal from the index.
Yes.
So for all these four stocks that I mentioned, I think that there will be more volatility moving forward as index tracking funds start to rebalance their portfolio to take into account these changes in the index.
Now, Kerwin, those two stocks, of course, RLC and MegaWorld, are both property stocks. Is this indicative of an overall performance, perhaps, of this particular sector, property?
Yes, for this sector, we think that interest rates will remain elevated for this year. So, of course, property stocks are the most will be most affected by this. Mm. But I think the reason for the deletion of Megaron and RLC is because of the failure to meet the criteria based on market cap. Because of this, I think that it will likely be affected in the short term, but in general, property stocks will be hurt by these higher interest rates.
Mm-hmm. Lastly, Kerwin, COL Financial, of course, has a huge retail investor base. How did this segment perform during the pandemic? I mean, did you see any growth, perhaps, or slowdown? And how do you think would they figure in the economic recovery story, considering we're picking up as a country? I mean, more people have some spare, perhaps, to invest.
Yeah, so based on our third quarter financials, we saw that COL has over 500,000 customer accounts, which is significantly larger than the 330,000 that we had pre-pandemic. So it's clear that the pandemic has really pushed a lot of people into the stock market. Mm-hmm. We believe that right now, COL is still in a good position to grow and further penetrate the underserved retail market. And I think to achieve this, we continue to hold various training seminars and workshops to be able to teach the public more about investing. So hopefully this year we can reach more people as we hold these initiatives on site and provide them with the tools that they need to make better investment decisions.
Okay, on that note, thank you so much, Kerwin Chan of COL Financial, for your market guidance. Have a pleasant day.
Thank you too, Stanley.